And then, all right, we have a whole crew of folks. Very exciting. So welcome to our Wisdom Wednesdays. Everyone can hear me okay? I'm excited to have Shahar, Zeevi as our facilitator and industry leader for today, who's really going to give us some amazing insight. He has a role as a manager, a father, a Jewish leader, on jobs and how to keep those bridges going throughout your career. And without further ado, Shahar, you ready? What I'd love to do is to first to hear from the folks that are on the call, just very briefly, what interested you in being on the call today? So introduce yourself, 10 seconds or less, share like what interested you in being the call today, and then we'll jump over to Shahar, and then we'll have some ongoing like Q&A interactive that Shahar's planned for us today, which is really exciting. So here we go. Awesome. Brianna, you want to go first?
Yeah, you're on mute.
Brianna, can you unmute yourself?
Do you hear me now?
Oh, there you are. Great.
Cool.
Yes, indeed.
Hello, everyone. I'm a senior at UCLA studying political science and communication studies. I'll be working in management consulting starting next August. And so knowing that I will be entering the field of consulting for a few years, I want to learn a bit more about how to redirect my career once I feel I want to leave the field and maybe enter into a specific industry. And what I am wishing for is an industry around the realms of technology.
Nice.
A bit about myself and my interest in the conversation today.
Fantastic. Thank you. Micah, do you want to go ahead?
Yeah, mostly wanted to join in for support. It was kind of as well curious about just what it had on kind of the inner genius part, things to work further on, the things to expand. So just kind of curious about that and wanted to just join in and listen. Now you're on mute.
You're on mute, Bradley.
Thank you for being here. So Shahar, are you ready? And then apologies in advance. I'm in San Francisco right now. We're building out our program, so I'm going to be jumping in an Uber in a little bit, but I'll be here. So thank you, Shahar.
All right, is anybody on a phone that is not on the Zoom itself? I see Gali, you join us. You want to introduce yourself? You're on mute. Gali, you're on mute.
No, I'm not.
Yeah, there you are.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Gali, I'm from Israel. I'm the chief prosecutor in the Ministry of Economy.
Oh, welcome. What brings you here into this call? What's the purpose?
I'm interesting to hear. It's my first All right. time.
All right, so a small group, so feel free to interrupt me anytime. Ask questions. So Bradley and I had conversation about managing your career. I do mentoring, working with students. And this is usually going through conversations and through processes and through days, weeks, and months as we just go and do stuff. So not easy to put it in words. So I tried to put it in words, and you're gonna see on the screen a snippet of an idea, and I'm gonna talk about it. So feel free to stop me at any time and ask questions or clarification or bring your view or question or need, and we'll work on it. So first thing is a disclaimer. Don't listen to the voice in your head. And if you think about what voice in your head, it's exactly that voice right now that told you, what voice in my head? That's the voice in your head, just to put it there. My answer may not be the right one. You may not think it's the right answer. May not think it's an answer. You may think that it's not what you were looking for, but all I can tell is this. My answer may not be the right one for today. They may not be the right one for tomorrow or the next day. My answer may be for the future you. One day, in a different time, different location, somewhere, those answers will make sense or not. Not everybody, you know, follow the same path. But those are, what I'm sharing with you is experience of myself and myself working with others and many things. So in some shape or form, one day you will be facing or maybe facing with those kind of questions or need for information, and that may help you in the future. So the aha moment may come. That was for the don't listen part. I'm not following the same view, actually. I just figured out that Zoom worked differently, and I didn't speak on the slide that I was looking. So who is in control? Who's driving your career? Is it your decision? Do you have a say in where career is taking you? Are you in the driving seat or someone else is in the driver's seat? Those are just questions that you need to ask yourself and be aware of the decisions that you're making and the path you're taking. Sometimes you may jump to another job too early, or you will look for a different opportunity in the same company a little too early, sometimes too late. So you will be in a position that not always you are the one driving your career. And you need to be making sure that you're making the right move for your career, not for right now. Maybe right now when someone offer you a little more money, it makes sense. Maybe when right now someone offer you a better position, it's flattering and it will make sense. It's like, yes, I want it. Yes, I can do it. Or yes, I can learn on the job to do it, which is fine. But is it the right one for your long term? Are you building your skills? If you're moving too quickly because you're good at what you're doing, you sometimes don't build your core competency or core skills or some knowledge that later in your career, you may look back and say, I wish I knew a little more. So just be aware of that. So don't wait for a sign. As I said, you may do it too early, you may do it too late, but you're not going to get the sign of when it's the right time to do it. So don't hold your back. Don't jump too quickly. Not even look at it the same thing personally or professionally in your life in general. Be in control of your path. That's a tough one. So when Bradley and I worked on this, the first thing was about this dream job. And I always joke that there is no dream job. And we'll touch about this dream job in few slides here. Again, the slides are just putting my notes together. It's more of a discussion. And I look at it when, especially if you are still a student or you're early in your career, or even myself, I can tell you that only in the past very few years, like single digit years, I'm starting to converge on what I want to do when I grow up, because it's not, there is not, you know, that dream job thing is not there. So my perspective is that there is no dream job. So don't immerse yourself too much into that dream job thing, overthinking it, making decisions based on it, trying to build that path to that dream job. First, you don't know what your dream job is. You know something you want to do today, but you don't really know what it is. And if you think you know what it is, you maybe don't have the skills to do it. So you need to look at how can I gain skills to go and do my my dream job. And the more you're going to do it, so now you're creating skills for your dream job. When you start building your skills for your dream job, you will find out that there are other jobs around that interest you, or other activity around that may interest you. And you start kind of like jumping left and right and up and down in your path to your dream job is some weird path that basically your passion and your need for knowledge and exploration will take you. And that's the actual life, and not just a dream job. And another reason I'm saying it is that there's no dream job. Be aware that the journey may be your dream job and not the job itself. It's what you do, where you do it, how you do it, and the learning part of getting to your dream job was your dream job. Actually, when you get there and you have to do it, it will be like, maybe I don't want, that's not what I want to do, because it's the path and the learning and getting the skills and executing maybe that part that you were looking for. So just look at everything as it all. Yeah.
Knowing that you've had a lot of experience just in a realm of different fields, how have you transferred skills you've learned in each job you've ever held into what you do now? Or have you felt you needed to do that?
So everything I learned, I used as my knowledge base, as my, the way I execute, the way I communicate, the way I do my job. I always use the tools I learned in the past.
Okay.
So every job that I held helped me with the next one. Maybe it's not needed for the next one, but it's a knowledge that I use to do it in a way that I learned from my own mistakes. I learned from others' mistakes. I learned from seeing other people do stuff that said, wow, it's amazing how they can hold the room together. Wow, it's amazing how they can communicate with people that I know you so much that you just cannot communicate. You just see people do stuff. You see yourself do stuff. You see yourself do stuff that you're like, I can't believe I did that. That was wrong. The next time it happened, you know it. You anticipate it. You're going to do it right. Mm-hmm. So you always use your tools. Now, if you look at your career from, I want to switch things. I want to move from one thing to another. That there's no correlation. It's like I'm switching industries and stuff. Your skills are still your skills. They are the skills that require to execute on that job, on that position, on that requirement. But you may need to learn more or different things to be able to execute it in that industry or in that company or in that something else. So yes, you may have to do learning, but I switch industries in the past. It's easier to do it when you're young and then when you're older, because when you're older and more in a more advanced position, they're looking to hire you for your knowledge. So they're expecting you to be that knowledge. And also, you're becoming too expensive for someone to teach you what need to be done in their industry. So you have to look at those things. Your skills as...
And I love that. Sorry.
Your skills as a professional will translate at anything that you do. Your skills in your specific job, specific title, specific industry, specific something, those may or may not translate, but you can overcome them. It's not always easy. Education may help. Online courses, free videos, whatever, gaining that stuff may help.
And I wanted to throw in, Shahar, also, if any of the other industry leaders, if Gali or Micah, if you have any thoughts related to this, since this is also an interactive dialogue, would also love to for y'all to jump in and provide any advice also for Rihanna on these questions. And it's being recorded, so other individuals will also be able to experience this post-experience. So awesome, jumping in with that.
Yeah, I mean, I could jump in on my side. I think along the same lines of what Shahar is saying, the recognition of what I lack and essentially kind of looking at that through, for example, my resume, seeing kind of what is missing that I think my next job or can provide for me with that. And so it's not just necessarily the direct skills of the current time, but realizing I need to progress along and what are the possible job openings further down the line that allows me to get to certain areas that I'm missing. So for example, in my career, in the past was missing kind of like, I hadn't worked previously at a very large brand and not having kind of company recognition. And in my field, that sometimes can matter. And so having that kind of foresight and plan of like, okay, this upcoming job may not be something I want to work in for a very long time, but at least long enough, get it on the resume, and I can use that as a stepping stone to the next level, to a real job that I want further down. And it's kind of that type of realization to help me in that path, and also is long-term planning.
Okay.
So, can I say something? Yeah. I can say from my experience in a different kind of job that sometimes you are looking for the dream job, and when you find it and you are almost there, you see that you have the skills, but maybe it's not what you wanted. Exactly what was said now. And I can say from my experience that I tried to be a judge, to be elected as a judge. And I was almost there. But then when I talked with judges and I saw what I'm doing, because I was just appointed to a chief prosecutor, I saw that what I have is better than to be a judge. And I really enjoyed the thought that I'll be a judge. But when you are thinking through, it's not the essence, it's not what I wanted to do. I wanted to be able to create policies, and the judge, he can decide on a case, a specific case, but he can't decide about policies and about broader stuff. So I think that sometimes you have to think through and be more open about what you need and not about the title. This is the first thing that I wanted to say. And the second one is that we need to think about the new world. In the new world, there is no real dream job, because every job is a step towards another job. And the dream is to learn from this job, the current one, to broaden your knowledge and your skills. This is what the new world is like.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. It's live with the fact that you don't know what you don't know. And with every little step, your knowledge is going to grow and going to give you a little more, a little open the window or build the puzzle to one day figure it out what it is that you want to do, that you care to do, that your desire or your passion taking you there. But you don't know what it is yet, because you only know job from seeing them by TV, by seeing other people doing the job, but you only see what they do. You don't know what the job that they had to do to just giving you that snippet of what they look like. So it's like, think about acting. There's someone that acting like, I don't know, there's someone that acting like a prosecutor on TV. And it's look cool to be the prosecutor on TV, but here is a prosecutor sitting here, and she's in the office from 6 o'clock in the morning till 8 o'clock at night, doing things that has nothing to do with what you saw on TV. And that's basically the way she envisioned being a judge. There's so many things that we want to do because this is what judge is for us. But when you actually learning what judge is, that's not really what I wanted to do. Again, the journey sometimes is more important than destination. And that's where the key here.
Cool.
So talking about that, and let's say you do think that you know what your dream job is, your first job should definitely not be your dream job. Your first job is where you learn the skills, is you learn to be professional. You learn what professional life actually look like. What does it mean to go to the office in the morning, be the office with people, deliver the task that someone asks you to do, work with different kinds of people and different kinds of managers and all the hierarchy of a company and being in the personal part of being a professional life in the office and a your personal life in your personal life and how they go together. Your first job is just giving you skills and you're teaching you about whatever you do right now. So again, you start building that job skills, that knowledge base that you're going to move forward with. And the key for your first job is to set you up to get your second job. This is basically the future of your first job should be, how do I get my second job? That's it. Don't look too much in the future, because remember, your second job may take you to a path that you don't even know exists. You're going to see someone doing something and you say like, wow, I really like what they're doing. Forget about my dream job. I really like what they're doing. I'm going there. So your first job, look about how you can get to your second job. and then how you can get your third job and your fourth job. And that's how you kind of slowly get there into your dream job.
Yeah. Cool.
So one day you're going to get to the point that if you wait, remember, there is no sign. If you wait for a dream job, it's not going to come. You need to ask for your dream job. Don't be afraid to ask for the job you want. Don't be afraid to build the job you want. Twice in my career, I work in an organization where I wanted to do something and the company needed it. And I presented it in a way to my managers and my leadership that this is what we need to be successful. Here is all the data. Here's all the information. Here's the people I spoke with. This is why it's going to do something. And this is the job we need. And I'm the best person to do it. And twice in my career, I got to do at the time, whatever was the dream job of the moment. And I created it for myself. Again, most of the times, unless it's like in hierarchy, jobs just exist. You may get a position or not, but many times just ask for it. People don't know that you want it. People don't know if you that you're interested. And you can miss an opportunity just because you didn't ask for it, because no one knew that you want to be a candidate and you won, and you didn't know that someone is looking right now. It could be that there's an open job right now, an open position in the organization that you don't know that it's in existence. Depends how big is the organization. And asking for it puts you in a position that people at one day when this position is available, they will say, huh, I remember Brianna once said she liked to do that. Let's check with her, see if she's still interested. So don't be afraid to do that. That anything in your life, asking is free. And not asking, it's a guarantee to not getting. You know, if you don't ask, you're never going to receive. But if you ask, it's free. And there's no negative points for asking.
Okay.
Now, you may already be in your dream job. You don't know it. You still have that forward thinking. You still know that you want to do things. But you may be right now, again, not you, you're a student, but in general, in your life, remember my disclaimer at the beginning. This presentation is talking about many things. And some of them may not make sense. Some of them you may disagree with. But at any time between now and your retirement, or even during your retirement, if you remember this presentation, those steps will come. And you're going to say, that's what he talked about. So that's another thing. Your dream job, you may be at your dream job. And you just don't know it. And you got and sometimes it's too late because you accepted the promotion. You chose to move to another company or to another industry or to do something different. And then you don't like what you're doing. You're looking back and said, wow, I really like what I did there. Or I didn't like what I did in my previous position or was whatever. Many times it's not really what you do. Many times it's where you do it. It's related to the company culture, to the people you work with, to the activity, to the professional life or personal professional life in that organization, everything together making it that this was the best place for me to work. I love the people, I love the culture, I like what I did, but in our head, people always told us that we have to do more, bigger and better. And I once in my career got the call that I always waited for. Shahar, we are offering you to be the VP of product management or VP of whatever. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yes, I became the VP. I hated it because it required to do so many things that I just didn't care about. I thought they're going to have more power or more, not power, but more influence and ability now to direct the products in the company, in my vision, in my strategy, in my whatever, which is true. But it also included managing so many people and managing so many different activity up channel to the company as the VP to talk to the C-level and in a financial way and in HR way. It just took all my days just to be a manager that didn't leave me any time to be the product. I was the visionary, I was the strategy, but I couldn't do anything about it. Mm-hmm. I could only manage the people that managed the people that did the product. Mm-hmm. So I got to the point that I learned too late that, yes, every time they told you, you want to do bigger and better, you want to get your promotion in your career, but I got there. It's not what I wanted. And that's where you have to step back. And you should, or again, you have to work on yourself and make the decision. Do I want to stay in this position because it will take me to somewhere in my career that I need to be the VP because I want to be the CEO. I want to be whatever, the CFO. I want to be on the board of some companies. I want to get to some places and it's just a step in my career. Or to say, oh, I need the money and this job paying the money that I want. Mm-hmm. Or I follow my passion. I actually want to do something that I want to do. You have to make that decision and that decision is yours based on it. Whatever the decision, and I hope it's my next slide because I'm trying to make it. No, it's not my next slide. Mm-hmm. Try to make my slides the way I'm thinking. You still have to do your time. And I think I will touch it in a few slides. You accepted the job, you need to finish the job. Yeah.
When I saw the slide, I thought about it in a different angle because sometimes what you thought is your dream job, and maybe it is your dream job, it can be like a golden cage. And it's good, you know, you like the people, you like the job, but it holds you back from maybe getting forward with your career and your ambitions. So I thought about it in this angle.
Exactly, again, and it's as I said, there's no right answer here. You need to make the decision, am I having an ambition in a career that this is a stepping stone, or I still want to follow my passion and do what I like and do what I'm good at and, you know, whatever. It's your choice. Mm-hmm. So talking about it, no lateral moves. If someone offer you, you're working for a company right now in a position X, and the competition or someone, a competition or even a different industry, doesn't have to be from the same industry, offer you the same job for more money. My recommendation, think about it very carefully. Because anywhere you're going to work, you have to put the time. Anything that you do in your life, you have to put the time. Anywhere you're going to work, there's a 2-3 years that you just have to do that job before you're going to do your next job. It's time that you're going to learn. It's time that you're going to explore. It's time that you're going to be learning new things in a different company or in a different position or in a different markets, in a different products, in the same organization or different organization. There's always something that, you know, you can build in those knowledge base. And if you quit too quickly because you realize that it's not what you want to do, you don't get to learn from a different aspect. And I believe that learning from your mistakes and failures give you a much better knowledge than from your success. Success doesn't really point to why you were successful, but failure is. So just to think about it, as you expand your knowledge, expand your opportunity, you figure out it's the wrong move, finish it, show resilience, show your character, finish it, and then move on. But be careful with lateral move, because when you do lateral moves, you did the job for 3 years, a different company come and steal you, offer you the same position. Now you have to do the same position for 3 years. And I'll tell you what, the money that they pay you is good for a few months. After that, you're just doing the same job now for 6 years. So money is not always an answer. Unless you need the money, and that's right. And if the money is important right now and you need the money because that's where the things are, then money is, it's the way to go. At any point here, you need to make the decision that worked for you at that specific time. And basically, here's my slide with the do your time and just finish what you started. I don't know what my next slide is. So I'll go back here. I mentioned, you know, learn from your mistakes. So I'll give an example from, I was in the Air Force and we did flight testing. And one of the things we tested was a new bomb. So you have all those computer things that, you know, you build all the models and you do all the calculation and everything look good. So you actually have a bomb that is strapped into a plane and you look at all the stuff and it look good. So that you're actually gonna take the plane and you fly it. So you fly the plane and everything look good and you land and you make sure everything is good and everything look great. And you everything just check. The checkbox is just clear. So now you take the plane, you fly, and you decide now you're gonna drop the bomb. It's part of the testing. We need to make sure the bomb actually do what the bomb was designed to do. And you drop the bomb, and guess what? The bomb didn't drop. The bomb stayed around the plane in that pocket of aerodynamic pressure that is under the wing. At one point, it actually flew up and hit the wing, which moved the plane a little, and then the bomb then finally fell down to Earth. Everything is videotaped. You know, there's cameras all over the plane. You see the whole thing. The plane take all the measurements and you go on the ground. And now you learn from those mistakes in theory. And in all the tests we did before, everything looked great. And if you decided to quit your job at that moment, you had a great career. But you didn't learn about the failure yet. You didn't know where something is wrong. In anything we do in life, there's bugs in anything. And you do when you do a new app, a new computer program, whatever the thing, a recipe for a soup. If you don't find the bugs, it doesn't mean they're not there. It just means you didn't find them. So it's very important to go through the process and learn. And the moment you learn from those points, that knowledge is golden. Knowledge is so much better than whatever you think you memorize from other things. Knowledge is true. So here there was that story analogy we are bringing from the Air Force. Only because the bomb hit the plane, we start looking at places where aerodynamic pockets live under the pressures and what caused the pressure. And then we learned that it was a fuel tank that was on that plane that looked different than the one we tested. So the fuel tank that the plane hold to fly to a further place, you know, distances created different pressures and blah, blah, blah. But all of these things had to happen for us to know that we did something wrong that otherwise looked great. So just a thought there. Ask question. Always ask question. Don't be afraid to ask the questions. If it's a new job, if it's about something you have to do today, it's about your job today, it's about the job you're going to take in the future, you're interviewing and you're asking, you know, people ask you, always telling you, ask them how it is to work there. Ask those people there what they think about the company they work for. Remember that you get their answers, not your answers. That place may be good for them, but it may not be good for you. The position may be good for whoever holding it today, may not be good for you. So asking those plain questions, you're going to get the answers that they're going to give you. Learn to ask the questions that really answers what you expect. And I'll give you an example for my kids. My kid will come and I'll ask them to, if they have homework, and they will say, I'm going to do it later before I go to bed. But wasn't my question. My question was just a yes or no answer. Do you have homework? It's a yes and no answer. It's not something that will go with, do you have homework? Yes, I'm gonna do it later. Or I have to deliver it on Friday. Or nah, it's fine, we're doing it at school. That's a great answer, but didn't answer my questions. So learn to ask those questions that will actually give you the knowledge you expect and want to get out of them, and not get their point of view and their subjective response to the generic question. Dress for the job you want. Okay, so I'm sure you heard it many times. And it's like, what does that mean? I always like thought that this is crazy. Like, what do you mean dress for the job you want? I don't know what the job I want. How can I dress for it? It's dress. It's basically be professional. If you behave like the job you want, you dress like the job you want. You dress like professionals in the office. You don't dress like you right now with whatever level of the company. Everybody wear jeans and flip-flops and drink Mai Tais in the porch. But the next level of positions, you see people start wearing a little more business casual. And at some point, maybe even wearing, you know, a tie or suit or whatever the things are. Be there. If you're going to start behave like the job you want, when the job you want become available, when people are being considered, and we look at our pool of available talent and say, we have a need. Who is that our talent can do it? You may be one of those our talent can do it. So now there's five people that can do that job. Who are we going to take? We're going to take the person that have the skills, and we'll take the person that we feel it's the better bet, that it will be successful representing that position. So if you already show that you look like the job, speak like the job, and know the job, it's a much easier for the company to give you that opportunity, because they don't have to now teach you, you know, for this job, you'll have to change your wardrobe, which is HR kind of like weird line to go to tell people how they supposed to get dressed or how they supposed to behave, because it's, you know, it HR today is a little kind of fine line. So if you start being there, the company see that you're there, the company will present you with the opportunity that you want. So just think about it that way. And your success will follow the level of your matureness. It's the same as like, you know, dress for your next job. The more you show your matureness, the more you behave, the more you people can trust you and they can work with you and they benefit from your work, and they see that there's or working with you benefit their career. They are successful because interacting with you, it's much easier to continue to want to work with you because you're helping them be better. And people are always going to align themselves with smarter people around them because that's how they get to do their stuff better. So that's basically what I'm trying to say with that slide, which go to, and I'm sure you heard it many times, be right over smart. Manage the situation. Work with people. Show that you are a team player. People will want to work with you if that's how you behave. I'll give you here two snippets. One, what's the difference between knowledge and wisdom? Knowledge is knowing that the tomato is a fruit. Wisdom is not putting it in your fruit salad. So I added in my career many times that using that, you know, not wisdom, that just be smart, not right. And I think, I have slides to covering it. Maybe it is my next slide, which it is. Don't do it for the credit. I had people that I did a lot of work and I worked hard and I went and presented things and people stole the credit or somehow joined into the credit of everything that I did. But that was fine with me. And I had some people come to me and that I can't believe you gave them the credit. I can't believe you went in front of the C-level, did all this presentation, and one of those VPs just stole all the credit. Why didn't you fight for it? And from my point of view, that VP was responsible for a lot of things that I needed to be successful. It was the VP of engineering. And I needed engineering to build the products that I, in product management, worked on that we need. And without engineering, those products were never going to come to life the way I wanted it. And that was part of my decision, is that if I played into the VP of engineering and they feel that they can be part of that glory, and they steal the credit and they feel good about it, I got what I wanted. And the more it happened, the more they worked with me. I was one of those product management managers that always got what he wanted from engineering. Yes, it maybe was 60% of what engineering did. And for 40%, they did whatever they wanted to do. But my 60% was a lot more than other product managers that had influencing only 30 and 40%. Because I created an environment for other people wanting to work with me because it was better for them, for their career, for their job, for their whatever, working with me. And that's that symbiotic relationship at work, that sometimes being smart is better than being right. And I touched before about experience versus grades. Remember, you're going to be five of you standing in line. Again, you're not really, but imagine it. There's five of you standing in a room. You all perfect for the job. You all have the skills for the job. Who we gonna hire to or promote? You're in a job interview with five other candidates, or you're working in a company with five other people that are being considered to do the next job. And from my experience, experience trump grades. So you can do great in school, but if you don't build your experience in your career, in your work, in every position that you held, you're gonna have a hard time winning the next position, because people that have experience in your next job, in the one you're looking for, you need experience in the job that you don't have yet. The one that can execute faster, better, and more easily the next job is the person that get the next job. It's the same as you're dressing for your next job, you are mature for the next job, and you have some skills of your next job, that definitely gonna help you getting your next job. This is, again, my opinion. Consider taking work break between degrees. So you're doing your bachelor's degree right now, mm-hmm. and you may have plans to take your master's degree immediately after. But remember, you don't know what your dream job is. You don't know what you want to do. You know what you think you want to do, but you don't know what you don't know. So if you take the time, take a year, take 2 years. Don't take too much there too, because do it when you're still young, where you still don't have too much of a financial burden with other things. But get some work experience. Figure it out exactly what it is that you think you want to do. And then go do your master's degree. Another reason to do that, now that you're working somewhere, your employer may offer tuition reimbursement. You may be able to get someone else pay for that job, for that education. So it's gonna help you, instead of recruiting more student debts, you're gonna have an employer that willing to pay for your education, because they believe that you are an asset for the company. You show them, you prove to them that you are good at what you do, and they're willing to invest in you, in your education. So first you're gonna have an opportunity to test the water if you wanna do what you wanna learn, and second, someone else may pay for it. Go, Bradley.
And also, I Shahar, I love that. And I want to also just note that we're coming up on time. So if I want to create a safe space for if anyone needs to log off, that you don't, that you feel comfortable doing so, and the conversation will continue. But want to just acknowledge that and name that, and say that that it's a safe space so that you don't feel locked in. And we're not ending the call right now because it can continue. But I just want to make sure everyone feels comfortable with that and respected with your time from our part, and allowing for more time for those that want to continue to engage in this conversation.
Hi. Bye, everybody. I have a pouring party, so
yeah.
Bye.
I didn't meet a friend to work on our final paper, but I just want to say thank you so much for sharing like all the insight about job positions and figuring out, especially that it's okay, like if you don't know what your dream job is yet, because that's definitely the point I'm at in my life. So it's good to hear knowledge about how you can just go about not exactly knowing exactly what you want to do, but feeling comfortable with what you're doing and always looking to just advance your skill set. So thank you so much for for speaking this afternoon.
And I encourage you, Brianna, and everyone else on the call. Also, everyone that's here is also on LinkedIn. So be sure to also connect with folks and building your network on LinkedIn with the folks that are on the call today, because it's a really great, we're really fortunate to have everyone that's here.
Which is perfect, segue for the next slide. Again, there's very few slides left there. Network, network, network. Mm-hmm. Always network. Whatever you are, if it's with people you work with, if it's people you meet on a plane, on the bus, and on a ballpark, it's your competition, it's wherever they are, always network. You never know who you're going to work with, which again, go quickly here. It's never burn your bridges. Everybody you're going to work with, everybody you're going to interface with, everybody you're going to do something with, most likely you're going to see them again more than once. I give an example. In 1994, 1995, not even 94, I started working in a company, I started a new company and starting work with some individual that he was in a different group than I was. We just met each other and we had these conversations and just, working the same company. A few years later, we both work still in the same company. We both work in a different division, in a different building, and now I'm working with them. Wow. Think about, I would say 7 years later, it's a different company. He's the CEO of the company and he hired me based on his knowledge of what I did in the past. Go to today. I'm working at like four companies away from where I was then. We bought we went to an acquisition and bought a company. And guess who we bought? We bought not him, in two companies away from the company I know him from. So he came with that company. And today, again, I'm reporting to that person. Yeah. He's the general manager and I'm the VP. And this is a relationship that started in 1994.
Okay.
So you never know how people are going to go in and out of your career and your life. Always be professional. Always be true. You never know when you're going to hit those people again in your career where, based on your past behavior, they may judge you wrongly.
Okay.
Now, if you have to go, I'll let you go.
I do, but thank you so much for that. That was a really cool anecdote, and I appreciate the time today. Have a good afternoon, Shahar.
You too. Bye.
Bye, Brianna. Thank you so much.
All right, Bradley. It's the two of us. You want me to finish my last four slides?
Yes, because we're recording it and are going to be using the clips.
All right, so fail often and fail fast. Don't be afraid of failure. People that show the ability to learn from their failures get better opportunities from the one that can't. So even if you fail is a good thing. It's not a bad thing. It's the ability to recover from failure and what you learn from it that show your character, show how you deal with it, because everything that we do in life, there's a potential to be successful or fail with it. And you not always have the right tools or the right knowledge of what's going to happen, but show that you can recover and learn and do better. That's a skill that people are looking for. Now, if you don't fail, I look at that. If you don't fail, you didn't try hard enough. If you don't fail, you don't really know your limit. If you don't fail, you don't have an opportunity to learn and gain more stuff. I always tell people and people that report to me that the joke that if you don't miss a flight every once in a while, you spend too much time at the airport. Again, it's not really good analogy, but it's telling you a little kind of like an insight into it. And travel the world. Many companies have offices all over the world. Many companies have customers all over the world. Take a position early in your career where that job will take you everywhere. And you travel on the company dime. You stay in nice hotels, you get good food, you seeing the world in a different way than it just backpacking with no money. In my first few years of my career, I worked for a company in the financial world, and we made software for investment banking, so that almost every trading floor or investment bank needed that piece of software. If they choose that piece of software, they needed that piece of software just to operate their environment. And I got to travel the world. I average about 150,000 miles a year going everywhere. And I tell you, it's great. It's like you really get to meet people, cultures, work with different things, which also help you with your career, because when you get to a bigger, better, different job, and you show that you have experience working with different cultures, especially if you're an international company, and you have that experience working with different people, knowing that the way we operate here will not work there. Those people just not going to work that way. You show that you are able to work in that international environment and with a big team that is globally located. That's just my advice. Always keep your resume updated. And the thing about it, from my point of view, is when you write your resume, when you're employed, you write it differently than when you are desperately seeking for a job. When you're when you're secure in your job and you feel that kind of that everything is good, the way you write your resume is about your values and how you're doing great today. When you're looking for a job, you're just going to list all the achievements that you think you did in the past, which is just a different way of presenting yourself. So my recommendation, always keep your resume updated. It's helpful. Also, you may need it one day, so good to have. And again, another disclaimer, we had one at the beginning. Let's want to have one in the end. Mileage may vary. Your experience may be different than others. Your manager, your peers will be different than mine. They are from a different generation of mine. I'm a different generation of you and your manager. So, well, I'm the generation of your manager. It depends at your where you are in your career. So things may look a little different, but there's a lot of similarities. So just be aware, remember to think about it before and after, and just be able to do that. And my last slide is, this is your spot, your place. As Bertley said, we all on LinkedIn, we all connected, we all part of this environment. Continue to build on this. Whatever you learn from here, pass it forward. Be a mentor. Teach others, help others. Come back to us, ask us questions. Help us make this better. Nothing is written in stone. Everything can be changed, everything can be learned differently, and answers that we thought is the right today, maybe not tomorrow. So feel free to contact, feel free to ask questions, feel free to continue working with us, and continue taking it to and share it with others. And that's all I had for today. Bradley, how do you want to close it?
Shahar, thank you. No, I think that this is really good, especially since the clips that how you did it, the clips when we go back and edit it and create like the short segments and then also have this online is really great, because it's like you talking. I thought this was amazing. Like, this was really good. So in closing, we have a lot of powerful and strong takeaways and small pieces of knowledge and wisdom, which is critical. And so I thank you so much, Shahar. And thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. I'm glad to share and collaborating with the greater team.
I think that I liked how Brianna was on here. And also, the chief prosecutor, and then also a software developer. Like, I think that the interactive, like them getting like involved in the conversation, worked really well. And thank you for all your time, and thank you for your wisdom and growing and building our community.
My pleasure.
Okay, have a wonderful day.
You too. Happy Purim.
Happy Chag Sameach.
Chag Sameach.
Hey, bye.